because you have the data in the cache. And then you attack this program and the...
Daniel, you found another victim whom you can explain computers here.
The attacker then flushes the data of the victim from the cache.
And why is the attacker allowed to do that?
Because it's an unprivileged instruction. Everyone can run them.
But why?
Because it's, well, that's in the instruction set, Manuel. The x86 instruction set is defined like that. It's an unprivileged instruction. You can't change that.
You can change that?
On ARM, you can actually do that. So you can ensure that the flush instruction can only be used by the operating system. So it's a privileged instruction. On x86, it's a bit more tricky.
Yeah, Claudio, I agree. So on x86, it's more tricky. That's actually what Google tried with their NACL sandbox for Chrome. So there they statically analyzed the binary and checked whether it contained the flush instruction, for instance.
Yeah, but we need to teach the students the underlying root cause, what the real problem of flush reload is.
That's a really good idea. We should go through this step by step. You could suggest a way to stop flush and reload, and then someone else points out the problem with that idea and how it's still possible to attack.
Okay, then I will start. The root cause of flush and reload of this side channel is the flush instruction. It's already in the name, flush and reload.
By the way.
Thanks.
Have you met our new neighbors?
I don't know we have new neighbors.
Yeah, so our old neighbors were evicted because the owners needed the flat themselves.
Themselves?
Yeah, but not exactly for themselves, rather for their daughter.
That's great. That's really, really great.
Great is not exactly the word I would be using. I mean, I have learned this is legal. If you need the flat for yourself, because it's your flat, you can actually evict the current inhabitants.
Yeah. No,
learned that at university.
Let me show you something, Manuel. So I have this. So this code here. This is flush and reload. And what we do here is we measure the time, we access an address, we measure the time again, and then we see this delta here, and then we flush it again. And that's great. The flush instruction, if you can't use it, you could replace it with eviction. Let's try that. If you take a look at this, so I'm running now just a histogram plotting cache hits and misses. And for the misses, I'm actually flushing the addresses. So if I flush them, they shouldn't be in the cache anymore. And here they should be in the cache. And you can see a clear timing difference. Now the question is, what happens if I use eviction instead? And I rewrote that code that we just saw. So now it looks like this. Very simple code. It's the same loop as before, but now I use evict instead of flush. And here, the eviction function, I just access a lot of memory. So I need the cache space now for myself. It's great. And
awesome.
This is just some memory access to that. So let's run that. Now we just have to wait.
Okay, so the first thing I noticed, the other one was definitely quicker here.
You see, it still works. It's still, this is still around 100, and this is different.
It still looks the same. So what's the difference then? I mean, it's the same thing, right?
Yes, it's the same as before, but that's the point. Flush, on some systems, flush is a privileged instruction. And if it's a privileged instruction, you cannot run it, as Claudio said. But on this system where you cannot use the flush instruction, you can still run this attack. I will give this a name. I call this evict and reload.
So that sounds like we were happy that attacks are possible. Shouldn't we tone that a bit down?
But we are. We are happy. I'm happy because think about it. What if someone decides, oh, I'm making the system secure by removing the flush instruction? Are we then secure? No, we know that we are not secure because there was this evict and reload attack.
So you say we should search for flaws, for insufficient steps taken against attacks, and then uncover them?
Exactly, to avoid getting a false sense of security.
All right.
And we described, for instance, evict and reload for x86 in 2015, for ARM in 2016. So removing the flush instruction is, yeah, not sufficient. I think we should go for the next possibility. So who goes next? Maybe Lucas?
Yeah, sure. So next root cause could be... Have you seen my watch anywhere?
Not really, no.
No? I mean...
Well, good luck.
Next root cause could be RDTSC.
RDTSC?
Yeah, so in general, any instruction that gives a precise timestamp count, like nanosecond scale.
Watch the... That's it? I have another ingenious idea. We remove the time. Think about it, Manuel. Think about it. We can remove the time. And both evict and reload and flush and reload need the time to work. And if we remove the time, then you can't run the attack anymore.
You sure? Think about the all the games that we played, like Hanabi or The Mind.
Yeah.
Doesn't anything come to your mind if you
yes,
think about
yes, this? Yes, yes, yes. I remember you cheated. You cheated by looking at a clock on the phone.
That's correct. And after you took it away, what did we do then? We started counting.
Yes, yes, but I show you the code here. So you can see this code very clearly here. We measure the time from here to here.
Yes. And
you want to count from here to... How is that supposed to work? We are...
I mean, a computer can count, right? That's easy.
Yes.
Step one. And I mean, can a computer only do one thing?
If you want to count from here to here, how would you would have to increment something or I don't know.
But your computer can do more than one thing at a time, right?
Come on, it must be obvious that at this point Daniel should use a counting thread.
Yeah, he should just write an endless loop in one thread and then increment the variable.
Oh, you could use multi-threading.
Okay.
With multi-threading, you could just add loop.
Mm-hmm.
And in this loop, you increment a global variable, like here. So you have
okay.
The counter, global variable, counting thread, and you increment that all the time.
But can it count fast enough?
Oh, I'm sure it can count fast enough if this runs all the time.
All right. Well... Maybe I get famous because of my great ideas on side channels.
No, man. Claudio.
Yeah?
Claudio, I had a great idea, ingenious idea. We can replace RDTSC with a global variable and still mount all the attacks, like flush and reload, evict and reload. They all still work.
Okay, but do you lose, like, timing resolution with that?
I don't know. How would I measure that?
I don't just... let your program sleep for a second, and then measure the time with RDTSC, sleep for a second, measure it again, and do the same with your global variable and see how much time has passed there.
Okay, let me implement that. I just need a minute for that. Think I got it.
Okay.
So I implemented what you suggested. So I run RDTSC, I take the value from the global variable, I sleep for 1 second, RDTSC again, counter again. And then I check what it prints. So let's run this. And here you can see it. So here we have RDTSC.
Mm-hmm.
This is the computer has 4 gigahertz.
Yeah.
And this is 4 billion. So we have 4 billion here. So that is one increment per cycle.
Captain Obvious strikes again. The cycle counter increments by a cycle basis.
Ah, yeah.
Yeah.
That totally makes sense. So what about the global variable? So this is 736 million. So it's a lot slower. There's only one increment in 5.4 cycles on this machine.
You should optimize that.
How optimized that? I mean, I wrote a loop, there's only one instruction in there.
Just write it in inline assembly. That's how you always do it?
Oh, yes, yes, yes. I can do that.
I'm not sure about it. Do you think that people actually know x86 assembly?
Yeah. But don't worry. It's just three instructions. Okay, so I did that. So I have that here now. So we have the global variable still here.
Yeah.
I copy the value into some register with this condition here. And then I run a loop, increment on this address. That's the address of the global variable. And then jump back to this label. So this is an endless loop incrementing. So it's now in inline assembly. And you said this is a lot faster. So let's try that.
Should be faster.
Yeah, it should be faster. So I'm running this now. And let's see. Oh.
Not much difference.
There's really no difference.
But
it was exactly the same.
Show me the code again. I think you can improve that further.
So this one here.
Yeah. That's not perfect. I mean, you always increment the value at the memory address. Just increment it in a register, move the results to the variable, but in the background you can continue to increment the counter. So that should be much faster then. So just increment the register and move the results then back to the variable.
Okay, let me implement that. Just give me a minute. Okay, so Claudio, I implemented this now, but how do I get the value back into this global variable?
Just use a mof instruction to move it back from the register to the global variable.
Ah, yes, of course, of course. So I mof this back into the into the global variable from the register. Okay, so it then would look like this. Does it make sense to you?
Yeah.
We have the increment, the mof, then the jump back. So this is then the loop.
Looks fine.
Okay.
Should be faster.
Okay, let me run this. Well. I'm not sure we are actually optimizing something here.
I'm sure.
Okay, I'm running this. And it's... whoa! It's down to one cycle.
Yep. Told you. It's faster.
What? Wait, Claudio, why? Why is this faster?
Wait. Now you're expecting that they understand out-of-order execution?
Not really. But if you take a look at the code here, you can see that the increment here doesn't depend on anything, so it can run at full speed. The mof only writes the value back into the global variable. So it also doesn't have to wait. I mean, it always gets the value from the register. And then it never reads anything back, so the jump also can always jump. So nothing has a dependency here, really, and dependencies are only what is slowing things down. So we don't really need to understand full out-of-order execution, just this simple example.
Yeah, it's a bit ahead, but we can link back to this episode in later season, so it's fine.
We should keep this short. So let's go to the next root cause, maybe shared memory?
First we thought the flush is the problem, the root problem of this flush and reload. And then we thought about RDTSC. Claudio, are you listening?
Yeah, I am.
Then we used the counting thread to replace RDTSC, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this was also not the root of the problem. What if the root of the problem is actually the shared memory?
But you have shared memory everywhere.
Yeah, can't we just disable that?
Yeah, have fun with that performance and memory overhead.
No, but seriously, I mean, I can compile a program as a static binary. Wait, take a look at this here. I'm running a histogram now on some shared library function that is used a lot. Here you can see it. A lot of cache hits, and if I flush it, you can see the clear difference.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. And now if I have the same shared library function, but my program now uses static compilation, then it should not use the shared library anymore, and I shouldn't see a difference anymore. Exactly. So here you can see it. You don't see a difference anymore because I couldn't flush this from memory.
Yeah, but it's obvious why. It's a static binary, so you compile it with static linkage, so all your shared libraries are directly copied into the binary. It just doesn't use a shared library anymore.
But that's great, right? If it's not shared, then no one can attack it. We can secure programs with that. We can, yeah.
No. It's just a binary. You can just mmap it, and then it's shared again. And it's in the cache, shared in the cache again. This doesn't solve anything.
You can prevent that.
If you prevent read access to the binary, maybe?
Exactly. If you can't read the binary, then you can't mmap it, and then you get no shared memory. And we stopped the entire attack. We are almost at the end of this episode, and then Lucas has a brilliant idea. He systematically goes through all the options. It's essentially flushing and timing the reload. If you can't flush, it doesn't work. If you can't time the reload, it doesn't work. If you can't even reload, also you cannot time the reload. But what if we don't have to time the reload?
I still see something, Daniel.
Oh, really?
Look at this.
What are you measuring there?
The flush instruction.
The flush instruction?
The flush instruction.
Why is the flush instruction leaking?
Wait. We're covering that in the next season.
Okay. Then let's rewrite this scene. The flush instruction?
The flush instruction.
We already said we don't use the flush instruction anymore because it's not unprivileged on all systems.
Right.
But it's interesting, and maybe you can replace it with eviction again.
Wait, give me a second. Let's see.
Whoa.
Look at this.
I think that's something really big.
It works.
I think we should send a mail to someone.